This land is barren and broken. It's scarred like the face of the moon. Our tongue, it is no longer spoken, and the towns around us face ruin. Will I find work in New Brunswick? Will I find gold in the cave? If I tunnel my way to Australia, oh, will I ever escape?
Where there's a mine or a hole in the ground, that's what I'm headed for, that's where I'm bound. So look for me under the load, or
inside the vein, where the copper and clay and the arsenic and tin run in your blood and get under your skin. I'm leaving the county behind and I'm not coming back.
To make Eden, granite and sea gave no choice. Though visions of heaven sustained us when John Wesley gave us a voice. Did Joseph once come to St. Michael's Mount? 2,000 years passed in a dream. When you're working away in the darkness,
deep in the heart of the sea, where there's a mine or a hole in the ground, that's what I'm headed for, that's where I'm bound. So look for me under the load or inside the vein, where the copper and clay and the arsenic and tin run in your blood and get under your skin. I'm leaving the county behind and I'm not coming back. Follow me down, Cousin Jack.
I dream of a bridge across the Tamar, but it opens us up to the east. And the English, they live in our houses,
and the Spanish, they fish in our seas. Where there's a mine or a hole in the ground, that's what I'm headed for, that's where I'm bound. So look for me under the load or inside the vein, where the copper arsenic and tin run in your blood and get under your skin. I'm leaving the county behind and I'm not coming back. Where there's a mine or a hole in the ground, that's what I'm headed for, that's where I'm bound. So look for me under the load or inside the vein. Copper and clay and the arsenic and tin run in your blood and get under your skin. I'm leaving the county behind and I'm not coming back. Follow me down, Cousin Jack.
Did we name ourselves Stranger and weep to defend each erosion? Did language slip from our tongues to lie in shallow graves with gods? We know nothing of our purpose from the stones which endure. Historians wrap long denial sheets about the scars on our heart. Our fields hold names in their corn to bless the barns and farms splayed from Maui to Cheesring within the echoes of bells. Women coil secretive charms about the saintly thorn when over the heather moor small slippers slip their way. What of religion's ropes and blades, its inquisition of books? Strangers named to justify laughter and furious looks. Strangers wiped like scratch from slate and names of fields recast. Oh, we who believe our future's owned must heed the wounds of our past.
When the waves roll over the waters,
The Last of the Smugglers by R.S. Hawker. Poor old Tristram Pentire. How he comes up before me as I pronounce his name. That light, active, half-stooping form, bent as though he had a brace of kegs upon his shoulders still. Those thin, grey, rusty locks that fell upon a forehead seamed with the wrinkles of 65. The cunning glance that questioned in his eye, and that nose carried always at half-cock, with a red blaze along its ridge, scorched by the departing footstep of the fierce fiend alcohol, when he fled before the reinforcements of the coast guard. He was the last of the smugglers. And when I took possession of the glebe, I hired him as my servant of all work, or rather no work, about the house. And there he rollicked away the last few years of his careless existence, in all the pomp and idleness of the parson's man. He had taken a bold part in every landing on the coast, man and boy, full 40 years, throughout which time all kinds of men had largely trusted him with their brandy and their lives,
and true and faithful had he been to them, as sheath to steel. Gradually he grew attached to me, and I could but take an interest in him. I endeavoured to work some softening change in him, and to awaken a certain sense of the errors of his former life. Sometimes, as a sort of condescension on his part, he brought himself to concede and to acknowledge, in his own quaint, rambling way, "Well, sir, I do think when I come to look back, and to consider what lives we used to live, drunk all night, idle abed all day, cursing, swearing, fighting, gambling, lying, and always prepared to shoot the gauger. I do really believe, sir, we surely was in sin." But whatever contrite admissions to this extent were extorted from old Tristram by misty glimpses of a moral sense, and by his desire to gratify his master, there were two points on which he was inexorably firm. The one was that it was a very guilty practice in the authorities to demand taxes for what he called run goods. And the other settled dogma of his creed was that it never could be a sin to make away with an exciseman. Battles between Tristram and myself on these themes were frequent and fierce. But I am bound to confess that he always managed, somehow or other, to remain master of the field. Indeed, what Chancellor of the Exchequer could be prepared to encounter the triumphant demand with which Tristram smashed to atoms my suggestions of morality, political economy, and finance? He would listen with apparent patience to all my solemn and secular pleas for the revenue. And then down he came upon me with the unanswerable argument. "But why should the king tax good liquor? If they must have taxes, why can't they tax something else?" My efforts, however, to soften and remove his doctrinal prejudice as to the unimportance, in a moral point of view, of putting the officers of His Majesty's revenue to death, were equally unavailing. Indeed, to my infinite chagrin, I found that I had lowered myself exceedingly in his estimation by what he called standing up for the exciseman. There had been divers patterns, he assured me, in his time in the parish, and very learned clergy they were, and some very strict, and some would preach one doctrine and some another, and there was one that had very mean notions about running goods and said 'twas a wrong thing to do. But even he and the rest never took part with the gauger. Never. And besides," said old Trim, with another demolishing appeal, "wasn't the excise man always ready to put us to death when he could?"
"Be content with simple things, make the best of what life brings. Be content to smile and say, 'Isn't this a lovely day?' Be content and thankful too for the good things given you. Happiness is heaven sent. It's yours if you will be content. Everyone has a different life. Some have peace and some have strife. Rich or poor, we can always find the blessing that brings peace of mind. Be content. things, make the best of what life brings. Be content to smile and say, isn't this a lovely day? Be content and thankful too for the good things given you. If you will be content.
Could be a fly, see the world through some different eyes, and I'd see this place for what it's meant to be. The sun will rise on another day, the troubles of today seem to blow away, but I'm stuck in time, the clocks won't change for me. Oh, I was born in a different time, wasn't meant to be today. In my head I'm back where I belong, in a life so far away. Oh, I was born in a different time, wasn't meant to be today. In my head I'm back where I belong, in a life so far away. Down the road in a world of my own, I'm laughing in my head, but in my thoughts I'm still alone, I haven't really met you yet. The winter skies and summertime seem to make the days go by real slow, but the clouds pass by eventually. Oh, I was born in a different time, wasn't meant to be today. In my head I'm back where I belong, in a life so far away. Oh, I was born in a different time, wasn't meant to be today. In my head I'm back where I belong, in a life so far away.
Our car cottages are made of wood, gables built of stone. You could fry eggs on a tin roof in the middle of the day. And the dirt and dust gets everywhere, hard to keep things clean. It's a full-time job to keep the flies away. Joe's making good in Wallaroo, copper price stays high. There's Cornish lads at work on every core. I can't see the headgear mile out on the hill, and the teamsters drive their wagons past my door.
A letter from Aunt Sarah Ann. Dear nephew, niece, and dear child, hoping this finds you as it leaves me at present. My old stomach is playing up, and so are my poor legs, and I got a cold in my chains, but apart from that, I'm all right. You may be interested to know that old Uncle Necky have gone dead. 95 he was. You know, he lived up St. Just way, had a donkey and cart. And he and Rosie, his missus, would bring home errands from Penzance for people up to St. Just. One day, coming home, they got so far as Mount Misery, and that old donkey took it in his head to go no further. Well, Nicky and Rosie, they pushed and shoved and dangled a carrot in front of him, but would he move? Not on your life. So, said Nicky, I dunno what to do. I'll shift him. We'll light a fire under him. That'll make him move. So they got some sticks and hay from over in the field. And you know what? That old donkey just waited till they had a rare old blaze going underneath him. And then he took three steps forward and burnt the cart. Yes, Necky is dead. Buried up chapel last week. Oh, that to bring me in mind of what that plumb neighbour of mine, Agnes, said to me on Monday. There we were, pinning out the clothes when she said, "It's her Anne. What do you think? I had the locust preacher to dinner yesterday." I said to her, "No, my dear, you've made a mistake. You don't mean locust. Locusts are they creatures in the Bible that devour everything in their path." "That's he," she said. "That's the one I'm talking about." I've got a new neighbour, moved in the other week. Well, I don't like the look of her very much. A bit snooty and arty crafty. She said how she was going to have a housewarming party. Well, I told her, under the coal and a bag of logs would warm her house up better. She said then that the party was going to be a cocktail party, and would me and Alfred like to come too? Well, when I didn't seem very keen, she said perhaps we weren't used to such things. Oh, but I had she. I said, "Who knew, my dear, we'd have so many cocktail parties in our house that our old rooster haven't got a feather left in his tail." Well, we did go into her party, me and Alfred, because to tell the truth, I've been dying to see what it's like in there. Well, you've never seen such things in your life. Didn't seem to be much furniture, so we had to sit on cushions on the floor. Oh, my back was some bad the next day. All the lights were out, just candles in bottles and jam jars round the room. I thought she might have had the electric cut off, but then I noticed she had something cooking on top the electric stove. Whatever it was, I thought it catched, for it smelt brim queer. She said it was called ratatouille, or some such name. We never tried that. She gave us this stuff called punch to drink. It had bits of leaves and trade floating in it. Alfred swore blue blind that she'd gotten mixed up with centipods in the dark, for his stomach started to churn as soon as he'd clunked it. There was a chap with a guitar sitting in the corner singing. Well, at least I think it was singing. Alfred reckoned he'd been at the punch and was crying out with the pain in his stomach. Well, just then, my neighbour decided to serve supper. She put this ratatouille on the table and what looked like a dish of boiled worms, something else called moussaka, and moussi was the right name for it because it looked rooted, not a bit of ham or lunch tongue to be seen. Even the bread was stinking of they old garlic onions. In the glimmer, Alfred nearly chucked himself on a splinter of wood stuck in a sausage. But then our neighbour said to Alfred, "Do have a little pizza." Well, he thought she was getting personal, so we come home. And I don't fancy we shall be asked no more. Well, my Ansoms can think of no more news. As always, Alfred to send his kind regards to all kind friends up there. Give the dear child a kiss from we, and look after yourselves. Your ever loving, Aunt Sarah Ann.
Thank you. you have a couple grandmas, a couple grandpas too. They each had two parents, and they're all part of you. Did any come from Cornwall? They very likely did. And if it's true, I'm calling you a very lucky kid. Were any known as Poldlays or Penrose or Trewick? Did any come from Mousel, from Lizard or from Gweek? Maybe some were miners or fished out on the sea. And if they did, I'll say to you what someone said to me. Surprise! You're Cornish, at least a little bit. Surprise! You're Cornish, you should be proud of it. Some people never find out until they're old and gray. Surprise! You're Cornish, and it won't go away. Cornwall is a country away across the sea. Some things there are very old or new as new can be. It's full of Cornish people, which comes as no surprise. And if you go and visit, you won't believe your eyes. Everywhere there's ocean, where you can swim all day. They even have some palm trees like California. The people tell you proper job and ask you how he be. And if you didn't know before, just listen here to me. Surprise! You're Cornish, at least a little bit. Surprise! You're Cornish, you should be proud of it. Some people never find out until they're old and gray. Surprise! You're Cornish, and it won't go away. Long ago in Cornwall, the people all were sad. They didn't have much money, things were getting bad. Although they didn't want to, they had to go away. They sailed on ships and took long trips to where we live today. Everywhere there's people, the whole wide world around. Cousin Jacks and Jennies, the Cornish can be found. It's great to have a family that's found in every land. To say I'm glad we're Cornish and take them by the hand. Hooray! You're Cornish, at least a little bit. Hooray! You're Cornish, you should be proud of it. Some people never find out until they're old and gray. Hooray! You're Cornish, and it won't go away. Hooray! You're Cornish, and it won't go away.
Thank you. I live in Buckinghamshire, so this poem is called High Tide in Buckinghamshire. Out in the copse, like fishing boats at anchor, beaches lift and ride, and as the branches stir, I hear the murmur of a Cornish tide. Over the fields, I watch the waves of grass blown rolling by the breeze. What benign calenture is this that makes me babble of green seas? I'm sorry about the difficult word. I don't like explaining my poems. I try to make them as easy to understand as I can. But a calenture, well, in Shakespeare, Falstaff dies babbling of green fields. And there is a disease which afflicts sailors at sea, which makes them go into a sort of delirium where they think that the green coloured sea is actually green fields. So to me, this was a benign calenture because in Buckinghamshire, I could see the Cornish Sea.
Cornish hedge. There is a philosophy and a practicality to a trade like hedging. Like when you're tobbing off, seeds of the future's in the past. In the earth you throw up top in autumn. Take time to learn that. There's a right way and a wrong way and everyone have his own way. You gotta live it to know. I like to work alone. That's what I love. I like to feel the wind on my face, hear the birds. Not just the singing. I like to hear the wings scurrying. What other job give you that? Why else do a job like this? You gotta love the country you're working with. You gotta be a part of it. You gotta listen to it. Smell it. Taste it. It all changed after the war when the farmers got on tractors. The old road man who used to weed round a group of foxgloves and cut back the corner for the motorists, he was a gardener. Up in the cab of a 4x4 tractor with a radio on, a man don't see the butterflies getting torn to death by the flail. That's because he isn't a gardener. He's in his head, worrying about his family, how he'll pay the mortgage. Now here's the thing, here's a paradox. That man in the cab, he's just the same as the Neolithic man who built the hedges in the first place. All he wants is to protect his crops and feed his family. He's different, but the same, see? Best time of night, dusk. Stone's nearly gone quiet. Just sitting with Edge, listening to the life in it. Beetle rustling. Or a lizard. Used to see lizards all the time. Don't see so many nowadays. This one time, I just topped off a piece up Biscoe way. One of they quiet and misty evenings when the past come up and meet you. I was sitting quiet-like, leaning against the foot of the old hedge. Down the field a ways from where I'd been working. Up come this fox. Sat next to me, so close I could smell his fur, musty-like. He'd been around some. He looks at me, and then scratches and yawns, disdainful-like. And he turns away and picks a blackberry. Real delicate, nose titched up at the end, lip curled back, and just nipped it off with his front teeth. Nosed in and around without getting scratched nor tangled like I do with the bramble. That's right, boy, I thought. You enjoy that. That's yours, that is. They berries were set just right for him, low in the field. Must have been cut well back last year, grow like that. Cut by hand, the old way. Fresh and young, old crop of them. Real good height for a fox. Must have been 5 minutes or so, me sitting. That old fox nosing and picking. Then he just looks round as if to say, I'm off now, pard, and he's up top the edge and gone. You gotta love the country you're working with. That's what I think.
Tame my lover's scorn. it melts the soonest when the winds begin to sing. Oh, the snow, it melts the soonest when the winds begin to sing. And the corn, it ripens fastest when the frosts are setting in, and when a young man tells me that my face he'd soon forget. But better crown, he'd be fain to follow it yet.
Minnick. The horizon light winks from the lizard on the tardy seagull creaking nestward, its hinge wings beating at the near dark. In a deckhouse square, a skipper with caution steers his fish-filled boat through the ensnared ocean, his feet throbbing to an engine hard at work. Giant rocks huddle the comfort close as they pass the lair of summer's dust, muffling the grass, where projected voices drown in quicksand froth. Players and people battling for attention in a pretend world of another's creation fade neutrally quiet before nature's cloth.
Thank you.